everybody. Welcome back to the 31 Days of Horror. I am your host, Moon616, and thank you once again for stopping in, guys. Yeah, welcome to Day 12 here on the 31 Days of Horror Volume 4. And we are going to take it back again to the 70s, specifically 1973, with a film that is titled Last House on Massacre Street, this little bottom one here. We're not going to be talking about House on the Edge of the Park. Reviewed that film many, many times. Of course, the classic by Ruggero Deodato. Now, this movie, Last House on Massacre Street, is not the original title. It's also known as The Bride, which you will see on the thumbnail, because I'm going to use that artwork. And if you look on the my TV behind me, it just says simply House on Massacre Street. This one has about 10 other titles. If you're interested in that, go look them up. But it's just really bizarre. It's been released as a different film and as a different name in so many different countries. But I think this was the title that they used when this made it to the drive-in era. And that's the one that they used because then they could basically pair it up with other House movies. So, which kind of makes sense for the Grindhouse drive-in era and stuff. But getting into the synopsis of this one. Basically, this one centers around a main character, Barbara. Now, Barbara is a very spoiled, rotten brat. Essentially, she comes from a very, very rich family. Her father is a lawyer, and she pretty much gets anything she wants. Now, she's a very eccentric type person, and specifically one day, she asks her dad if she can build a house, of course, with his money. At first, he's pretty reluctant to the idea because he's like, he's like, you've been spoiled your entire life and stuff. He goes, now you're going a little bit too far. He kind of says this. But he gives in and he lets Barbara build a house. Now, what Barbara wants to do is she wants to get married to her boyfriend, David. And essentially, her father is not down with this idea one bit. Even though David works for him, he feels that David is a little bit off. You know, there's something wrong with him. Of course, she gets her way. She ends up marrying David, and on their wedding night, she walks in to this upstairs bedroom where David is making out with his girlfriend. Of course, she proceeds to grab a pair of scissors, slash up his arm, and then fucking disappear off the face of the earth. Like, literally, just disappears. So, it's been a few weeks, and David is now living with his girlfriend at his house, and all these crazy and strange supernatural occurrences start happening. And yeah, that's the synopsis of the film. Now, my thoughts on this movie, you can tell this movie was shot on a shoestring budget. I think it may have said 30 to 40 grand this movie was made for. So even back in those days, that was still very, very low budget. The thing I like about this movie is that the director knew how to make his money go a long ways. There's not a lot of locations in this movie. There isn't a lot of actors and people and stuff. But he hired quality actors. The acting in this movie is actually really good. The sets and the locations that they used are also really good. I think the highlight of the movie is the cinematography. It's shot really well. It's shot very eccentric. It's got very odd angles and stuff. It's shot kind of like how the characters are in this movie. Barbara being very eccentric and strange. The father, he's a little weird to himself. He talks weird and stuff. I just feel like the cinematography and the way this movie looks reflects the characters so well. It's very interesting. Now, the first 30 minutes of this movie has a very happy, fun-feeling soundtrack to it. And of course, after the event at the wedding happens, the shit gets a little bit darker. And I like that, man. It changes tones completely. If you were to just watch the first 30 minutes of this movie, you'd be like, that isn't even a horror movie, because really nothing horror-ish happens. But then it gets to the point. This is another really short watch. This one clocks in at about 76 minutes. And unlike some of the movies I reviewed earlier in the 31 Days of Horror, I wish this one actually had have gone on a little bit longer. Because once the strange occurrences start happening to David and his girlfriend and shit, it's pretty intriguing because you're like, what the fuck happened to Barbara? Like, the whole time you're like, what the hell happened to her? Like, she disappeared. And, and that was it, The only thing you get is her voice on it. She would call and say, oh, this is your answering service and things like that. But you never get to see her, and it's very strange because it's very much a pretty cool mystery. And so that all happens, and then the build-up is really cool, and then the twist happens, and it's pretty damn cool, man. I really enjoyed this movie, it's super entertaining. I mean, if you don't want to check out this film for any other reasons but pure entertainment value, give this one a shot. This is actually really cool, man. You know, it's not going to be that, you know, gory film. It didn't cheap out and use shitty gore effects and stuff. It really relied on atmosphere and the creativity of the suspense. And the cinematography is a great element in this film that really just is the huge highlight to the movie, man. It really is. I love some of the angles and shit they shot. Now, the house that she builds, super cool looking. I don't know if that's like a real house or what the fuck that was, but man, that design on there for 1973, pretty damn cool, man. Pretty cool shit. But Last House on Massacre Street, aka The Bride, good shit, man. Really, really good shit. You know, it's not very often I say I wish a movie was going on longer, but you know, in this case, 76 minutes could have been a little bit longer. Now, apparently there is a longer cut of this movie at 85 minutes. I don't think it has a release. It might just be some alternate cut. And I have a feeling that alternate cut just might be more padding of the time with dialogue and stuff. We're not missing any gore or anything like that. I think all that's present here in this Code Red double feature. The transfer is actually pretty good. I was expecting it to be a lot shittier than, you know, than I got. It's pretty crazy. So, that's good. I haven't checked out transfer. I have the single Blu-ray for this anyways for House on the Edge of the Park. So, but I solely bought this just for this release. I know there is another release with this too, but it comes with this weird drama movie. And I was like, this just looks a lot better. This is the first pressing of it too, the one with the red. If you're interested, because I've actually had comments. People have actually inquired about that, why there's a red and a blue cover font. This is the original and they repress it with the blue. But yeah, Last House on Massacre Street, man. If I had to rate the film, I'm going to give it a solid 8 out of 10. I really enjoyed that movie. I would definitely rewatch that movie. Some really good stuff, really good stuff. So yeah, I'm so happy I made it through this review without hacking my lugs out, because I am really fucking sick right now. I started feeling like shit yesterday, you could probably tell, but now I'm super congested, super shitty. I've been hacking my guts out all day. And I actually made it through this. This is pretty impressive, because I was just hacking my guts out for like 20 minutes. Not puking, but coughing my guts out. But yeah, so that's going to do it here for day 12, guys. Check you in day 13. And I don't know what I'm going to do for day 13. I picked up a bunch of films. I've had some recommendations or some requests for reviews and stuff. And you know what? Stay tight. I might get to some of those. So check you guys tomorrow. And as usual, deuces!